Welcome to Talking All Things Business. I'm Faye Waterman, and today my guest is Rachael Downie. Now, Rachael began her career as a teacher with a background in agriculture and hospitality. She branched out into educational consultancy and leadership before beginning her mentoring and coaching business. She joined the Proctor Gallagher Institute in 2016 to work alongside Bob Proctor and to help wake up the world to what is really possible. Rachael is passionate about helping others achieve success and transforming the paradigms and self-image of adults and children to allow them to become the best version of themselves. Wow, Rachael, welcome and thank you for your time.
Thank you, Faye. It's great to be here with you today.
Good. Now, Rachael, what Talking All Things Business is about, it's about you. So what we're going to do today is, what made you get to the stage that you are today, the steps along the way? What inspired you to become a teacher in the first place?
Well, it's a really interesting question because when you look at all the, you can't connect the dots looking forward. You can only connect them looking back. And so everything that I've experienced has got me to who I am today and, you know, allows me to do what I do. But I actually had gone through university doing an agricultural science degree because I wanted to work all around the world. And that was something I thought would take me there. And then when I finished my degree, all the jobs ended up being up the north of Tasmania and I didn't want to go and do that. So I thought, what else could I do? And I fell into teaching and thought, well, I'll just do that for a few years.
So you didn't actually practice agricultural...
Well, I did a number of months of work placement in certain areas on different farms and ended up then working on my now husband's farm as well. So, I got quite hands-on with in orchards and in dairy farms and land marking and lots of other bits and pieces along the way.
Right, but that didn't stimulate you. So what got you interested in teaching?
So I think I was born to be a teacher. I mean, what I do now is teaching, but I just love being able to convey knowledge. I've always loved learning. It's something I'm very passionate about. And, I ended up teaching in a rural at the local school that I was in. And I ended up setting up an RTO there for years 11 and 12 students who wouldn't go on to college and mature age students as well. So a lot of vocational education.
Right. And what was it like teaching in a country school? Did you get to teach in a school in town at all, or did you just teach in country?
Yeah, so I had taught in schools in town, but the interesting thing in working in a rural town is you've got to win the respect of the kids. And that was something that I was able to do, I think, just naturally in who I was. But emotionally, if they weren't feeling stable, they're not going to learn. And if they don't trust you, they won't learn either. So it was an interesting time. I was teaching agriculture, and a lot of the things the students were actually working on their on farms, driving tractors and machinery, and would have to come to school, and they weren't allowed to do any of that. Workplace health and safety. So it was a real sort of toying of, I understand you can't do that, but while you're here, this is what you have to do. So yeah.
So it was a bit of a torment for them, but it was a different structure altogether, wasn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. Very different structure. Yeah.
And, you know, when they were learning, were they willing to learn or were they distracted by other things?
A lot of them were more hands-on learners that I got that would come in and choose agriculture as a subject. But that probably ended up being quite a small part of what I did over my years of teaching as I branched into more in the vocational side of things. So I worked a lot with students on confidence and their self-image and how they could be going after the things that they wanted, and the mothers, the mature age students that came in who'd had children younger and then came in and did things like aged care or business or childcare and things. And again, same thing, working on confidence, self-image, belief, that kind of thing.
Right. And when you were living on the farm and you were helping your husband do that, and you also have four children.
Yes.
How was juggling four children working, going to work as a teacher, but also having children at home and, you know, running a household and helping with the farm and everything like that. What was that like for you?
Well, as you can imagine, it was incredibly busy. My cup was full. And I'm glad I now do what I do, because back then I had what we call a self-approval by achievement syndrome, in that it didn't seem to matter what I did, it was never going to be enough. That I would try and please my husband, I would try and please and look after my children, I'd be pleasing, trying to do the right thing by, you know, having a good secure job. But inside, you know, it was sort of getting to the point of I really wasn't doing what I wanted to be doing. Now, don't get me wrong, I wanted my children, but it was like, how much more can you take on, Rach? You know, running, you know, the business with your husband and doing the books and the book work. And then, you know, I was also studying as well. And I look at it and listen to you speak that and go, oh, my lordy. Crazy.
How did you manage it? And it's really interesting. You actually go through the process and do what you have to do at the time.
But absolutely.
What was the realization for you to leave teaching and then go into coaching and mentoring and doing that sort of thing? What was the instigator of that?
Well, interestingly, because I worked for the government, they can move you. And I'd sort of come backwards and forwards having my children, and I'd set up a program, Careers by Design, and it worked really well. It was fantastic. New principal came into the school, didn't know who I was, transferred me out. And I ended up just working in an area or in a school which really was not of no interest to me. And it took me about 4 weeks and I went, you know what? I'm not making a difference here. I'm done. So it was really a gift, because I'd been sitting on toying about leaving teaching, because I thought, well, I'll go into it for a few years and then I'll change. Well, 3 years turned into 15. So it was actually a blessing, because then it caused me to have to, well, what next? What else am I going to do?
And so 15 years of teaching and then into coaching and mentoring. What was the transition like for you?
It was a pretty tough one, actually, because if I think about it, I was teaching students and things confidence and belief in themselves, and I started my own coaching business and I didn't have the belief in myself. I didn't have the confidence that I was worthy. All I wanted to do is have this deep inner desire to help people, and I wanted to do it for free because I didn't feel like I could charge. So I had a lot of this self-talk going on in my own head about wanting to help people, but I was, doing it at a very low cost.
Right. So how did you manage to then coach people if you didn't have the confidence to be able to do that and charge them? What was it?
It's a really good one, Faye. So I remember doing some consultancy work for a private company down here, and I sent my invoice to them after I'd done the work, and they sent it back to me and told me it wasn't enough. So it was like, no, you can't charge that. Okay. So it was really about learning to go outside my comfort zone. So it was like people could see my value more than what I could see it.
Yes. And that's normal with a lot of people, isn't it? So when you were actually creating that invoice to send it in, you're having this self-talk about, oh, well, I do this much, or I charge less or whatever, and then you got it back, they sent it back to you and said it's not enough. What was the feeling inside of you then?
Well, I think, Faye, that's a great question. I'm sure a lot of people listening maybe would, feel the same way, but it kind of gave me permission to charge more, in all honesty. And I'd spent so much time evaluating what I should charge, almost procrastinating not sending that invoice in. And then when it came back, I was like, oh, okay then, I need to charge this much, all right, I'll do that. And that was easy, and it felt amazing. It felt really good. It was like somebody else had given me permission.
Yes. Well, they actually did, didn't they?
Yeah.
Gave you permission to take a look at yourself and look at your self-worth and say you're worth more than you're actually
absolutely
showing up as. So after that happened, what was the next step for you?
The next steps were continuing, I'm trying to remember what I did then. Yeah, so I was doing educational consultancy, and then I'd moved into with the coaching as well, and trained in emotional coaching. I did a lot of study in NLP as well, and became a practitioner of that. And then, but I didn't sort of practice, it just became an arm of the coaching I was doing. And then with the children being young, I had really wanted to be the best parent that I could be. So I was studying all the books that I could around parenting, because, you know, for the most important job in the world, we really don't do much to learn how to be a good parent. And at the time, I had a child that I was using a lot of my coaching with, who really struggled with her emotions and with behavior. And as a result, ended up writing a parenting book on called Parenting with Hope. And it was really about helping people. It was my journey of how I moved and used the coaching to move from being frustrated to being calm and relaxed. So then I really combined my education. So I studied my master's at the time to write a literature review, which became the book.
How long did it take you to write that book?
Well, it seems like I had been writing it for a while. Like I was so connected with the desire of what I wanted to express in it that I'd take paper in my car, and if I'd pull over somewhere and have to brainstorm and get things out. But I ended up sitting down because I had all of these notes, and in the end, I actually wrote the book in a weekend.
Gosh, yeah.
Yeah. So I'd sort of organised to do a program that was writing this book in a weekend, and I sat down and followed their system and had my book at the end of it. But writing the book is really such a small part of the actual
process. Yeah. So after you'd written that book and you practiced on one of your children,
yep.
What was the inspiration to move further forward into the coaching? What was it like to have more confidence in you?
Well, it was interesting. I suppose there's a bit of a gap in there. I also ended up in a network marketing business. So I moved into that and did very well because I got to do my coaching. I got to share. There's no way in a million years, if you'd said that I'd do that, that I'd be doing that. But I did, and I learned so much about myself. But a big thing of that business was about personal development. So the coaching went hand in hand because I'm so passionate. I just love to help people to become successful in their own right. And so that's what I'm saying. A lot of my story and my journey, I had to connect the dots looking backwards now and seeing how all those pieces of the puzzle came together to create who I am today. And so having done that business, I felt again that I got to a level of success where I was stuck. I was really stuck.
And what was that like? What was that feeling like of being stuck?
Pure, utter frustration. So I'd done so much work on myself emotionally as on a personal level to show up and be a really great mom and to be calm and relaxed. But in my business life, I was coming from a place of frustration because I just couldn't seem to get ahead. Didn't matter. I was a massive action taker. I've always been a doer, but I just couldn't get the pieces of the puzzle to work for me.
So what changed that?
Well, a day back in October in 2016, somebody shared a link with me, and it seems like actually, it was in the May, sorry. They shared a link with me and I opened it up and started watching this material and I went, oh my God, this sounds fantastic. And so I enrolled in a program online for the October of 2016. And it is my now mentor, Bob Proctor, who did a 3-day seminar on paradigms. Paradigm Shift, it was called. And within the first half an hour, I had this emotional impact where I burst into tears, sobbing, and went, oh my God, there is nothing wrong with me. I'd spent my entire life comparing and looking outside going, well, everyone's got that success, there must be something wrong with me. And I'm not just sort of saying, hey, that it was a deep core belief that I had.
And what gave you that deep core belief? What was it that...
As a young child, I had glasses and I didn't feel good about myself. And I can remember at the age of 3 and 4 and then comparing myself to other children. And then I didn't feel worthy. I just didn't feel worthy as a child. And this played out into everything. But I had this inner desire to succeed in life. And it was like a drive, a determination, persistence. There was just something within me that I wanted to be better. I wanted to do better. I wanted to have better.
And you wanted to help others.
And I wanted to help others.
Because you knew how you felt as a child and you don't want others to feel.
And I didn't want others to suffer.
Yes.
So in this, in this first half an hour, understanding that these beliefs and habits and behaviors that have been passed on genetically and from the environment that we'd experienced, I started, oh my goodness, because I had two parents that were only children who really lacked confidence themselves, who, happy doing what they're doing, but that's not what I wanted.
Yes.
And I wanted more.
Inside.
I saw what others had and I wanted it.
Okay.
So I saw we didn't have that many friends growing because mum and dad were quite insular. But the one friend that we did have, she was an only child and her parents travelled overseas and, you know, she went on trips and they'd bring her own gifts and the way she was treated, I want that. And I want to give that to my children one day when I have them. So it was very interesting that a lot of, and that's what I'm saying, when you look back on things, you can see how you've shaped.
Oh, definitely.
When you become aware of it, definitely. But many of us aren't aware of it. And that's what I love helping people to do, to become very aware of this programming because I wasn't aware of it. And so for me, that was like, oh my goodness, how have I gone through my entire life and not known about my conditioning that's been impacting me? And I'd been so conditioned that I had to get a good education. So I'd learned that that's what I had to do, but it didn't seem to matter how many degrees I had. And that's what I thought I had to do.
Nothing changed.
Nothing changed. So it wasn't about the amount of knowledge that I had. Lack of so many things. It came down to three things, and I share a lot of it in the book that I wrote, The Secret Million Dollar Paradigm. It's understanding your self-image. You cannot outperform your self-image. Now, that's not what other people see. It's how you see yourself on the inside.
Yes.
The second thing is a money paradigm, and that is your conditioning around money, what you believe you're worth and deserving of. And also what you learn about money. And the third thing is your sales paradigm. Now, every single one of us is a salesperson. Every single one of us. We are, every human being is selling a product, a service, or an idea. And the way I mean that is every parent is selling to their children the way they want them to behave. A wife might be selling to her partner how she wants them to do a certain thing, or you might actually be in sales, selling a type of product, whether it's in a coffee shop or in retail, in building, whatever it might be. But we are all selling a product, service, or an idea. So if you're in sales, then you need to have a really good image of a salesperson, but the majority of us don't. And particularly in Australia, we don't have a good image of salespeople.
It makes me smile. Just, it brings up lots of things there because, as you said, everyone is a salesperson. Everyone is selling something. And if you're selling an idea, first of all, what are you selling? You sell first.
Yeah. And that's the key. You've actually not just got to sell yourself to others, you've got to sell you first on you.
You've got to work on you first.
You've got to work on you. It is all an inside job.
Yeah.
And the key is there is so much potential locked up inside of all of us.
Yeah.
But these paradigms, these habits, beliefs and behaviours create a prison. They're like prison bars that stop all the awesome stuff about you from coming out.
they can start working on. So once you're in that first half an hour of the sessions with Bob and you burst into tears, what was that real realization for you?
Oh, I had the book here. I haven't got it right beside me. He read out something, and it's out of the book called U Squared. And it was about a fly buzzing on its last day of its life up against a window. And it doesn't matter how hard that fly tries, it is never going to break through the glass. But keep trying harder is what it keeps doing, and buzzing and buzzing and buzzing, doing the same thing over and over, expecting a different result. That fly was me. That fly was me doing the same thing over and over, expecting things to be different, and they weren't. What needed to happen was that the fly needed to look for an alternative, look at things a different way. And if it had just turned around, there was open door that it could have flown out of, and that would have been the key to its freedom. And when I heard that story, that's when things changed. Because I went, I don't need to be like this. This isn't me. And there was a quote that he shared, if I want to be free, I've got to be me. Not the me my parents or my partners think I should be, not the me my kids think I should be. If I want to be free, I've got to be me. So I better find out who me is. And that's what I set about the journey doing.
And, you know, there are a lot of people that think they know themselves, but they don't really know themselves at all.
Yeah. So what you shared is so true. It's around awareness. So we are taught that through schooling, we have to pour in all the knowledge, right? The more knowledge we have, you know, then the success, right? But actually, it's the potential of drawing out and becoming aware of what is already inside of that person. It just needs a way to come out.
Bring it out in that imagination, that fantasy.
Yeah, and bring it out without the paradigms, removing the beliefs, the belief systems that don't serve you.
So when you finished that 3 days and came away from that, what was the feeling for you? What were the emotions?
Oh, I felt liberated. I felt freedom. I felt like, you know, if you could imagine, I'm thinking what I was, 42 years of age, thinking that there'd been something wrong with me my entire life. It was probably the first couple of days I felt that there was stuff right about me.
Really? Isn't it? And what an amazing awareness that is, when you realise that there is this magic inside that is just waiting to come out.
Yeah, well, that's when everything changed.
Yeah.
So there's something I share with my clients of everything I believe is true. That day my beliefs about myself changed. And that was the start for me of where I felt I really started to live my life. Not the life that I thought I needed to be living, but the life that I wanted to be living. Because I'd focused so much on what I didn't want.
I didn't focus
on what I did want, because I didn't know what I wanted.
But you do now.
Absolutely.
So after that, then you started doing things with the Proctor Gallagher Institute. Let's talk a little bit about that and what it's brought to you in your life, but not just to you, but for others.
Yeah, okay. So I started myself in getting mentored by Bob Proctor and working with him and learning and studying all of his material so that I could go out and teach and facilitate it. Because I've become so passionate about the breakthrough for myself, I wanted others to have what I had. And I started to build a business. So I live in Tasmania, and I started out within the first 18 months with clients all around Australia and in India. One of the key clients I worked with had people that the business was based in Tasmania, and they had a team in India, and they had a team in Melbourne as well. Working with individual clients and in leadership teams. And then over the years, that's, you know, worked with people from graphic design businesses to hairdressers to private industry, building and construction. It doesn't matter what the job or the business is. we're all the same.
And striving for better, aren't we?
Yeah.
We don't know how to do that.
And it's tweaking. I think one of the biggest things that I was sharing with a client today was about helping people to make decisions. Nobody's ever taught us really how to make a decision. Most of them have been made for us. And so that's where a lot of time and energy is wasted, because we procrastinate and we go to everybody else. What do you think I should do? What do you think I should do? So a key thing for everybody is learning how to make a decision. And when you do that, you will have way more time on your hands, way more energy, and learn to trust yourself.
And that word trust is a big thing, isn't it? Learning to trust yourself and then allowing others to trust you so that then you can go and work with them and help them to trust themselves to be able to go and do what they need to do or want to do.
Yeah, so a lot of what I teach, I mean, I study every day myself to be able to help myself grow and to be able to give more to my clients. And what I'm studying is my awareness. And so over the past 4 years, my awareness has just grown and grown and grown. And in that time, I made the decision that I wanted to write a book. And in doing that, I had no idea. I knew what I wanted to write and I started writing it, but it was so funny. It ended up becoming a completely different book. And as it sort of took fold, I sort of wrote it in three parts, but I didn't know how it was going to come about. And so in learning and studying this material, and I spent a lot of time overseas, traveling to Canada every 3 months to work with Bob and his team. And I had the idea while I was there for one of the trainings to interview self-made millionaires, because I wanted to understand and share with the world my understanding then around money and, what our beliefs were, what our habits and behaviours were in order to be able to bring more prosperity and abundance. And I'm not just talking about money, it's in the sense of the richness that we can have within our lives and changing people's perceptions around what that is. Oh, absolutely. And what changed my perception around money was when I heard the quote, the more money you earn, the more people you can help. And all I wanted to do was help people. And I thought, oh, wow, okay. And it just flipped my perception. So with this book, I had my own goals and dreams about what I wanted to achieve with that. And I did. But again, it was all through using the material that I teach and applying it to my own life.
And not only to your life, but your family's life.
Absolutely, yes. Well,
let's talk a little bit about the benefits that you have when you have young children and you're teaching them this material. Because when they become adults, they will have a different viewpoint on life and what they want. They'll know. They'll be aware, so that awareness will be there. So talk a little bit about that.
There's a couple of incidents that come to mind when you're talking. And when I started this material, it was in the October. And in the November, I think it was, my daughter at the time was 12 when she wanted to start running her own business. Now, my previous conditioning and thinking would have been no. Whereas this opened up my mindset as to what was possible. And so she's now 15 and she's been running her own business and produces Dolce de Leche, a caramel sauce from the milk from our dairy farm. And she's branched out into preserved lemons, pickled walnuts and quince paste and fig paste when we have enough and the birds haven't eaten it from the farm. But she had a goal in mind and she wanted to get this in boutique stores throughout Tasmania and interstate, and she achieved that. She had the belief in herself that she could do what she wanted to do. And also the conversations that we have within our family and, the understanding. They have this understanding. The other one that pops out, I think, is my second daughter, who we were looking at her having to go to high school. And she made the decision she wanted to stay where she was. And I found it very important, because I've talked to my children about decisions. They have to make the decisions for themselves. And so it provide the options So when we have friends coming over and we ask them what they'd like to eat for dinner, they go, I don't know. My kids go, no, you have to make a decision. And it's really simple, but you see how it plays out in it from a parenting sense. And so my daughter had made the decision that she was going to stay where she was. So I'd gone on one of my trainings, and the day I got back, she literally burst into tears when she saw me, and she said, Mum, I've made the wrong decision. She said, I based my decision on fear. I was scared of not wanting to go to the other school, but I would like to go. So in teaching them what fear is, I think has been liberating, because they need to understand what fear is and go outside their comfort zone a bit, because that's where the confidence is. You've got to gain the confidence through going through that fear. And she's had the best education in the last couple of years, and loves it, but also knows. So she keeps recognizing, having to just test herself that little bit more, and then she'll second guess, and she goes, oh, I know, Mum, I'm coming from fear. And she's able to self-regulate that. She has a strong understanding of her emotions and her thoughts.
And isn't that amazing that a child of a young age can make those decisions and have a conversation about it and realise what they want, what they don't want, and also to know who they are and what their fears are, because a lot of kids don't know what their fears are.
Well, a lot of parents don't know. I was one of them. And so to be able to help that understanding and awareness, I mean, I even remember watching my son, I think he was 10 at the time, walk off a cricket field, and one of the mothers dealing with their sons and saying, oh, I just wish that he had a better attitude. You know, he always comes off upset with himself and in tears. And, you know, we always use these two questions. Well, what did you do well and what could you improve on? So it's teaching the children to have a good attitude and show up, and how that then impacts them in their sport, because two of them are playing elite level sport too. So it's not just in, you know, one area. This covers all areas of your life and understanding who you are and how you're showing up.
And attitude, let's talk a little bit about attitude, because that is, can I say, the number one priority in our life. If we have a good attitude, everything seems to work out for you. But if your attitude's not on track and you think, what's going on, but you don't really know, because you don't understand what attitude really is,
yeah,
how do you decipher that? What is it that you do?
Well, attitude, I think, was the key. This was what I understood when I started studying this material more, was that I was a massive action taker. And people on the outside saw me incredibly positive, but on the inside, I actually had a really bad attitude. And our attitude is something that most of us don't understand.
So what is attitude?
So attitude, the way that Bob Proctor teaches it, is it's a composite of our thoughts, feelings, and actions. So it's a little bit like a cake. You don't go along and say, oh, it's nice eggs, or, you know, nice flour. But we need to have this understanding of thoughts, our feelings, and our actions. And the three of them combined together create almost like a radio signal for us. So if you've got a good attitude, you're gonna have good results. If you've got a bad attitude, bad results. So it's learning how to get those thoughts, feelings, and actions in alignment. And when you do that, your whole world changes. So go to my business to start with, I was taking massive action, but I was not backing that action up with the right thoughts and the right feelings. And I remember working with a leadership team, one of the women shared, oh, I've got the thoughts and the feelings, but I'm not taking any action. So it's great, because people could quite easily then see what was missing, what needed tweaking. And I regularly do this with my clients, and, you know, all of them say, like, attitude's the key. And, you know, when you change your attitude, everything changes.
And I totally agree with that, because I know when my attitude is not good.
And how do you feel?
I can't really say.
It's such a good indicator. But if you've been conditioned that way for so long, sometimes it's hard to recognise that you're in it.
Yeah. Well, I do these days, but once upon a time, I would never have recognised it, wouldn't have understood it or anything like that. So, you know, you talk about the learnings. We all learn, and we are gifted things, and those gifts give us, can I say, a greater awareness of who we are and who we can become, the person that we want to be.
And we are already that person. There's perfection that exists within us. It's just that our beliefs don't allow us to see that. So if you think about when a baby's been born and you look at them and they're flat on their back and they've got their arms wide open, and they're just lying there, that's pure vulnerability. Yes. But it's pure spirit. We see the perfection. And then as that baby starts to grow, the doubts start to come in, the worries start to come in, the lack of confidence, perhaps the lack of belief, whatever has been, perceived from the around surroundings. And then you start to see the change.
Yes.
And it's probably about 3% who have a belief and they retain that belief and go through life believing they can do anything. But the majority of us don't have that self-image. We don't hold that of ourselves.
Because of the circumstances and the environment that we grow up in, and then when we meet people such as yourself who can create that awareness, those aha moments that you do with all your clients, to give them, I suppose what I want to say is a different thought passage, so that their thoughts are starting to change and their awareness is, so that their language and everything else around them starts to change because they look at themselves in a different viewpoint.
And that's the key. That's where it all starts. So when I was working on emotional coaching, there was something that preceded the emotion, and that is your thinking. Your thoughts are energy. So your thoughts become things, as a man, as a woman thinketh. So this was all information that was known back in the 1930s that somehow wasn't being able to be distributed worldwide. And when you start to understand the impact, consciously, our thoughts control 4% of the behavior that our body takes. 96% is based where our feelings and our habitual behavior. So 96% of our behavior is habitual. You know, you don't have to think about, you wouldn't have thought about when you put your pants on this morning, which leg to put in first. Okay, you probably would have put your makeup on and not thought about it. Or when you were driving a car, I'm sure most of us have driven the car and got somewhere and thought, I actually don't know how I got here, I wasn't even in the car. But when we first started driving that car, we had to really think about it because it wasn't a learned behavior. So all of this habitual stuff, we tell ourselves to do something and then we do the exact opposite.
Yes.
We've never been taught how to discipline our mind so it doesn't discipline us. And that was the key, is we've never been taught how to use our mind. I was a teacher, I've done a lot of education, never been taught how to use my mind until the last 4 years. And then I never taught a student how to use their mind either. And it is the most powerful.
Yeah. And so I look at the education system when you talk about that, and look at the education system and I know your thoughts about it, kind of. And I think, how do you change the way the students are taught so that they are able to think for themselves and make decisions and understand what the consequence is when they make that decision? And that consequence is something that they have to take on board and be responsible for, and not have the blame game, because a lot of the time when things go wrong in our lives, who do we blame? We look for the closest person we can to blame for it because it's not our fault.
But the reality is, if it's meant to be, it's up to me. And so if you want to change your world, you've got to change yourself first. That's the responsibility. And I think Wayne Dyer shared this quote, when you change the way you look at things, the things you look at change. So it comes down to perception. I mean, even with what's going on in the world right now, things are changing in regards to education. I don't think it will ever be the same. Things will transform and change. And there is a global movement. People are wanting greater connection. They're wanting understanding. They're wanting, you know, they are wanting things to be different. So there will be a shift. It's just not, you know, it will happen. It's not if, it's just a matter of when.
Yes, and that, I look at what's going on in the world right now, and I'm excited about it in one way and sad about it in another. But, you know, the good things that will come out of what's happening now, there will be good things and there will be not so good things. But that is a part of what we need to learn as communities and individuals, to take responsibility for who we are, stop the blame game, and create that awareness that being kind to somebody and sharing and caring is really important.
And that's when it comes to attitude.
Yes, yes.
So there's a four-step process that it is what it is, harvest the good, forget the rest, and then ask yourself, what do I want?
And that is exciting. So when you're working with a client and they're unsure of who they are and what they want, and they've been like that all their life, what is it that, how do you detect the good things? How do you bring something good out in them so that they can start then realizing, okay, their self-awareness and their confidence is building?
I think one of the, I really follow through using Bob Proctor's material because he has over 59 years of experience in this. I don't think there's anybody else on the planet that does. So one of the key things is working with people and finding out what it is that they really want, not what they think they can have, what they really want. Mm-hmm. And then we go through a process of looking at what the things that they know they're doing and that they're not doing, and helping them close the gap around that. Mm-hmm. Teaching them how to use their mind and not to be influenced by outside circumstances. Mm-hmm. And then I think the key is in building this new self-image. Mm-hmm. The self-image of the person that's in alignment with what it is that they truly want. Building their attitude to be in alignment with that. And then learning how to just put more good out there. You know, it's all about how we can put more good out, how we can help others, how we can help others become successful. And in doing that, that's what is put into circulation. So it's just like the circulatory system in our body. You know, we need to share it all around.
Absolutely. It's no good if it's stuck inside you, if you can't share it.
And so what happens is it's helping people with their own awareness. So the more I understand me, the more I understand you. So in working with a client today in building and construction, I was talking with him about, you know, having to make decisions and where he was wanting to go with his business and expanding into property development and things. And I sort of said, you know, the man that is going to achieve this goal is not going to be the man that's sitting here with the same thinking that you have now. You are going to transform and change. So who do you need to be to be that person and start acting as if that person right now?
Yeah. Yeah.
And closing the gap in a number of areas to be able to help him to do that.
Yeah. So it's pretty exciting work that you're actually doing. So how do people get in contact with you?
So you can just go onto my website, www.racheldowney.com.au. And my details are there. You can book a call with me if you would like to have one. Or you can also, I've got this book here too that I wrote last year.
Yes.
International Business Advocacy Goals. So The Secret Million Dollar Paradigm, where I've interviewed Bob Proctor and a number of self-made millionaires from around the world, three men and three women. And you can just order that one on Amazon as well. But they probably could get in contact with you as well, Faye.
Yeah, oh well, they can get in contact with me and I can give your details to them, so yes. So
if you are listening to this recording, one of the things, you know, in chatting with Faye was to be able to offer you a complimentary strategy session for yourself, and if you would like to take that up, you're more than welcome. Just say that, you know, you've heard the interview from FAIR myself. And as I said, I'm just so passionate about helping people with a breakthrough. And it doesn't need to be a big one, but if you can just shift the way that you see yourself and understand who you truly are as a human being and what gifts you have to offer and your impact in the world, that you can make a difference by being you, the real you.
The real you. Thank you, Rachael. Thank you so much. Great information there, and hopefully people will come along and want to talk to you, connect with you and work with you. So thank you so much for your time. I'm Faye Waterman. This is Talking All Things Business, and I'll be back another time.